Well, we are truly going around the world when it comes to looking at global real estate and what's going on, some of the trends. Sheikh Khalid, Bruce Flatt, and Rob Speyer, thank you so much for being with us. This is what I would call a dream team when it comes to talking real estate. What I want to start with is the truth about what's going on in real estate, because there have been over the past year a lot of conversations about doomsday scenarios, about people leaving major cities, a lot of working from home or hybrid working, so we won't need as much office space, about people moving away from gateway cities. So I want to get to the truth of it. Bruce, let me start with you. Is it a case that we're not going to go back to our office? Or if I look around New York, it feels like a lot of people have already moved back.
Look, it's life is about phases. People have to adjust. They're all coming back to the office. It's just inevitable. And but people have to do it in phases. They thought they couldn't come back. Then they thought they were going to partly work from home. Eventually, they're all going to be back at the office. We're seeing it everywhere in the world. You can see it in the cities that are reopening already across the world. And it's just happening at a slower pace in some places. But everything's opening up where the vaccines are working.
Sheikh Khalid, come on in on this. Do you agree you're seeing everybody come back, or do you feel like that there might still be some dramatic changes when it comes to real estate generally?
I do echo what Bruce said. I think in phases, as we have planned also here in Qatar, many of the companies, agencies, organizations are coming back into phases, and I see with the people getting vaccinated, even a larger pool of people getting together in terms of meetings, events, what have you. I think we cannot get away from the concept of the workspace. The concept of workspace is for many occupiers is to pool talent and to promote collaboration and innovation. So this concept we see in Qatari Diar, where I am a chairman of, we don't see a change from that. I think we're getting back to normal. I think as a growing company like Qatari Diar, it's important that we maintain the attracting talented people. And in the same time, as a growing company, we are developing and training national to as a successor for the future. And we cannot do that remotely.
Rob, is it 3-for-3? Do you agree that people are coming back from the office, or does something change a little bit in terms of how we look at the office space, maybe how we use it or how much we use it and where we are using it?
Companies are really struggling to define what a hybrid workplace means and how to implement that in an equitable way. Does it mean that nobody works Mondays and Fridays? Does it mean, as one big company's doing, you tell people which 3 days they come to the office based on a computer algorithm? Do you give every employee their own choice? How does that work? So I think companies' approaches have been very fluid, depending on seasonality month by month. And it has been a real struggle if it's not remote or in the office, and it's a balance of the two, how to actually execute. But I'd give you a fact point from our kind of on the ground experience. We were lucky enough to buy a building in Sunnyvale a couple of months ago at a 50% discount to the pre-COVID value. Within 30 days of closing, we have two tech companies who are looking at potentially taking the whole campus. Now, 6 months ago, the whole world was writing off the Bay Area. Everybody was moving out, moving elsewhere. And the facts on the ground are most of the big tech companies have added extraordinary numbers to their workforce, and they need places to put them. Nobody's making the bet in actuality that they're not bringing people back to the workplace.
Well, that's what I want to get to and kind of make some sense out of, because we've done a lot of stories, certainly here at Bloomberg, about people leaving Silicon Valley, that the big tech companies are saying you can kind of work anywhere. Bruce, who is it that's going to be in demand for office space? Is it the same as it was pre-pandemic in terms of what we see post-pandemic? What signs are you seeing?
Look, I think the one thing that people have forgotten about when they think of office space is normally workforces, the GDP of the world grows. And you need more space to house people. And what happens when you have a slowdown is that nobody builds buildings. And there really hasn't been anything globally launched for 18 months, which means that this the amount of buildings coming on is just getting less and less. And over time, what you're going to see is demand come back and the amount of supply diminish, which means that you're going to have a whole cycle start over again. And our view is that, you know, this is very positive for real estate longer term. And we're continuing to invest globally. And you can see it in each of the markets that open up. You start to see cap rates come down because people understand that the offices are going to be full again. And if you don't understand the business or people aren't in the business, it's maybe hard to understand. But that is really what's going on at the ground level.
Sheikh Khalid, what are you seeing? Like the other two on the panel, you have exposure, obviously, to the office space. Lusal, I think about your massive development that you guys have been working on since 2005. What are you seeing in terms of office demand? Who needs it? Who doesn't? Because there are certainly lots of stories about, you know, open office space in Doha specifically.
Well, I can rephrase it in macro and micro. If I will talk macro, I think the office space demand will continue, especially for big corporations, technology firms, as said by Rob, and also for the professional services that rely on a large talent pool and looking for also best locations, best space. If I talk about micro here in Qatar, we went through I think a surplus of office space. Because it has to do with the demographic, with the planning, what have you. But I think, but that's also has a benefit of reducing the cost per square meter, which is also encouraging tenant to move in and looking also for more of the smart cities, I would say, or smart offices. That's where the technology is being upgraded and has more a sustainable and well-being location for the employee to move in. So basically, best locations, best offices will remain as a high flyer.
Sheikh Khalid, foreign workers are so important to Qatar. We know that. Are you hopeful in terms of, you know, immigration policies? Are you counting on that and really changing demographics to help also fill those buildings and the demand there?
Well, definitely, and we've seen a change on the policies for immigrants to move in and to give more of leverage to the business here in terms of the doing business or residency. Definitely, that's helping certain cities, certain location within the state of Qatar and within Doha, and we've seen that going toward the right way, so to speak.
Bruce, I know gateway cities are certainly, you know, on your radar and you still see strength in gateway cities. Is there anything to the argument that some of the secondary cities, because of companies that do offer now as a perk, kind of flexible working, that we will see kind of more investment going into those secondary or tertiary cities?
Yeah, look, all of them are all of the above are good. There are smaller cities that are highly attractive, Nashville, Austin, where people want to be and they're growing. But just to put it in perspective, we're building a major complex in downtown Nashville. It's the office, mm-hmm. residential, retail, a big mixed use development, but it has 400,000 square feet of office. we ourselves own 60 million square feet of space in New York City. So it's just the quantums. And as Rob said earlier, to get the people, and as Sheikh Khalid said, to get the amount of numbers, you need to be in these big cities. So Facebook, Google, and many of the tech companies are in New York City because it's the only place that they can get the mass of talent. And that's not to say that Nashville isn't going to be important, but it's just the quantums are different.
Bruce, while I have you, I want to talk a little bit about retail specifically. You guys have big exposure. You bought GGP back in 2018. The timing on that, did it cause you pause certainly over the pandemic year?
Look, we started buying it in 2009. We bought it four parts of it, and the last part we completed in 18. So, but yeah, look, retail was not great when they shut down your business and it goes to zero for a couple of months. It's not fun. But if you take it today, numbers are coming back strong. If you have great centers in great cities, people are strong, and actually sales in many of them are above where they were pre-pandemic. So. Sales are coming back, and yes, there was a little bit of a pause, but those that were well-financed, just like every piece of real estate in the world, those that are well-financed live through these periods of time, and we're all trained to do that in the real estate business.
Right. And my understanding, Bruce, is that you recently did some channel checks, and you were checking out some of the malls that you guys saw that you own in the United States, and it was busy.
It has been reported that we toured many of those centers across the U.S. recently, and it's amazing the traffic that are coming into retail centers. Now, some of the urban centers, in fact, are the ones that are the most hit just because offices haven't filled back up yet. But we take great comfort from we have a mall in Seoul that's underneath two office buildings that are now virtually 100% occupied with people. Not just leases, but the mall underneath is full. And so where things are opening up and vaccinations have occurred, you are getting you're getting traffic coming into both office and retail.
Hey, Rob, talk to me about something like a Rockefeller Center, right? Which is so, you know, having worked there over my career, you know, it's a place where there's lots of tourism, it's multi-use. I mean, all of you are so much, you know, it seems to be one of the significant trends when it comes to real estate, these multi-use properties. What are you seeing in Rockefeller Center specifically?
Yeah, I mean, look, if you take Rockefeller Center as a microcosm of New York City, the difference between May 1st and June 1st was like watching a flower blossom. And the amount of activity, the amount of people coming here to eat, to shop, to go to our observation deck, and yes, to come back to offices, the difference in 1 month has been pretty extraordinary. And you're seeing that play out across New York City, in the parks, on the streets, and in real estate. I would also add, if you look at our, retail is a very small segment of our business, but if you look at China, where people are back in the office and where domestic consumption has been stimulated by COVID because people can't leave the country, so they're shopping more domestically, they're traveling more domestically. Our couple of shopping malls in China are performing better today than they did pre-COVID. So you hear a lot about the negative news in commercial real estate. You hear less about the cohorts like life science that are performing extraordinarily well, where demand has been accelerated by COVID. You hear less about cities like Austin, where we bought two buildings. They were empty when we bought them. While we were in contract, we leased both up. So there have been great opportunities during this period. We've done more than $12 billion of deals globally during COVID. And we think they're going to be some of the best investments we've ever made.
Well, talk to me about deals and where money's going, because I think about something like the hospitality industry. Say, Khalid, you guys certainly have a lot of exposure throughout the world in terms of hospitality. Are you finding new opportunities because of some properties that have certainly been beaten down, depressed because of the pandemic?
Well, to be honest with you, we work with our partners. Locally, we have not looked at opportunities, but abroad, yes. And you are talking to our partners here, both of them, and we always work with them in order to find the best opportunity. We build on and capitalize on the relationship that we have. That we have built over the years, and I think the U.S. is a great place for investment. And I'm happy to hear what Rob have said about, occupying or buying post-pandemic or after the pandemic those good deal of offices. But I think this is an area maybe we need also to sit and chat and talk about it. It's a great opportunity. But to be honest with you, locally we have not looked, because we are focusing mainly in Al Wusail city. We're building facilities to cater for the COP, for the World Cup 2022. And also we are marketing the boulevard. This is a commercial avenue that we have built, and it's really is doing great in terms of the attracting people to rent, and variety of people. And this will be one of the kind of a commercial boulevard built in the state of Qatar, close to the Al Wusail Stadium, where we'll have many of the games taking place in. And really, this is where we are focusing in Al Wusail right now. As you know, that Qatari Diar went through a restructuring of itself from organization-wise and from investment, and we continue to focus on UK and US market with our partners. So we haven't really secured any opportunities inside Qatar, but as I've said, we are concentrating on what we have in hand.
Sheikh Khalid, one quick follow-up on that. The World Cup, massive for Qatar, and I understand that there's a big focus in the development towards that. What happens to demand after the World Cup?
I think a great infrastructure has been built in the city, in the city itself, with all the regulation that has been put in place in terms of the tourism, attracting tourism to the state of Qatar and to Doha. Many events that's coming in a place which I don't have really in mind, which will make Qatar for future events most cost effective when to host any future events any future events in the state of Qatar.
Bruce, in terms of new money, committing new money, where are you looking? What types of projects are you looking to do right now? Where do you see the opportunities?
Look, when you have a $225 billion portfolio of real estate, you're doing everything. And we've been buying a lot. We've been selling a lot. On the growth side, we've been doing life science. We just are committing to a portfolio of life science in the UK. On the value side, we've been buying office in city centers, and we just bought $750 million of properties in Washington. We've been buying in New York. We're buying in London. We just committed to a large building in the city. So on the value side, we're finding opportunities to put money to work. But on the growth side, which are often smaller dollars, there are still significant opportunities. And the real thing, and we haven't talked about it here, Carol, but the real thing is interest rates have gone to zero, and they look like they're not going up in a substantial way for a long period of time. And as a result of that, and once the clutter clears from real estate, and the as Rob said, the shift has changed a lot in the views of real estate. Once it takes its final shift, people are going to realize that these are among the great investments in the world to own.
Well, Rob, do you agree with that in terms of, I love that you went there, Bruce, in terms of interest rates, because it's certainly something we debate and talk about a lot. Do you agree rates are going to stay low and that provides incredible opportunities?
It looks that way, but there are obviously some inflationary pressures that are suggesting that while rates may be low for the next couple of years, they'll gently rise to prevent a run on inflation. While we haven't had an inflation spike for a few decades, I think there are enough of us who remember the 1980s and double-digit inflation that's obviously something we're preoccupied with. I agree with Bruce. There are extraordinary opportunistic things to buy in major cities around the world. We've been active during COVID in Paris, in Washington, D.C., in San Francisco, in London, and people just selling off real estate at 25, 30, 40% discounts. Whereas if you had a long-term view of things reverting anywhere near where they were pre-COVID, these are generational buying opportunities. I also think there are growth segments like life science, where we've been extremely active, like prop tech, which we haven't talked about, but we've been very aggressive both in early stage investing and also a couple of SPACs that we've sponsored. Technology is finally transforming the real estate industry, one of the last industries that kind of opened itself to innovation and disruption. And now that's become an extraordinary force and investment opportunity. So I think the things we've been doing have ranged from deep value investing and also investing in certain real estate pockets that are seeing enormous growth right now.
Rob, you mentioned technology. Expand on that. And specifically, what does that mean? And I'm thinking about the Bloomberg audience, the global audience. What do they need to take away from that?
Very little changed about our industry, other than really the way you capitalize buildings. Very little changed about our industry for many decades. And I think most people in real estate thought their responsibility was to provide four walls and a floor, and in return, get a rent check. And that was kind of the contract with tenants. And you saw your tenant every 10 or 15 years and renegotiated, and everything was very transactional. That has changed now, whether it's software or hardware solutions or new, more flexible models. Our industry is going through this enormous period of disruption and change, which, if you position yourself at the forefront of that, is a fantastic opportunity to do a better job serving your customers and investors, and also a great investment opportunity if you position yourself not just as a real estate investor, but also an investor in the technologies that are changing real estate, which is what we've done both in creating a venture platform for early stage investments and also sponsoring SPACs that are able to take growth stage companies into the public markets.
Which is a big change. Sheikh Khalid, I want to have you address something that Bruce and Rob talked about in terms of interest rates. What are your expectations, you know, when it comes to the global rate environment and the opportunities it presents for the real estate community and investing?
I think I echo both Bruce and Rob. I think we will enjoy a low rate interest for a few years to come, maybe a couple of years, maybe more. And it's an opportunity that we see that investment opportunities, which will help also in terms of investing because of the low rate interest. Also refinancing when it comes to our position, Qatari Diar, we are refinancing our facilities, facility loans, with taking the advantage of the low rate. But they are opportunistic, and I think globally, which is really a time to go for investment and enjoy that opportunities.
I want to kind of turn the tables on you all and see if you have a question for one another. Sheikh Khalid, do you have a question for Bruce or for Rob here?
My question is, how do they see, would they invest, I mean, talking about investment on in offices and office space, how do they see the appetite going further, especially in the major cities? Do you see people might trend away, go away from major cities and build, maybe go to the hub of the social hub of the big cities and invest more? Or you think the major cities like New York, London, and Tokyo, Paris will maintain their position post pandemic?
Bruce, you want to take that first? So I think I know your answer.
I'm going to set Rob up here. How about that?
Deal.
Major cities are major cities because transportation and because of that people want to be near others. That's why they've always existed, and that's why corporations seek those cities. Rob can give whatever answer he wants, but he should tell the story of all the companies that left New York City and went to Stanford and how many stayed there and where they are today. And I think that's instructive of the as a answer to the question.
The ball is in your court, Rob.
Now, Bruce, thank you for that. I remember being a kid in the 1970s, and watching my father and grandfather struggle to keep our properties leased because so many conglomerates were moving to Westchester and Connecticut. And most of those companies came back within a few years or went out of business because they couldn't attract the same talent once they moved to the suburbs. In my lifetime, I'm 51, five times, and I've spent my whole life in New York, five times people have been predicting the death of New York and the death of cities. And every time they've been not just wrong, they've been profoundly wrong. And through crisis, New York and other big cities have innovated and made themselves better. And that's been happening not just for 51 years, but for hundreds of years. And again, if the four of us were together in New York City right now, and I'm sure the same would be true if we were together in Doha, you would see an active place where people are super happy to be and they aren't going anywhere. And you want to look at the Bay Area, unless Stanford is moving, tech companies aren't moving. Yes, they're going to hire talent in places like Austin and Bellevue and Toronto, but they're going to stay headquartered as close as they can to Palo Alto because that's where the great talent is produced. And if you were to want a roadmap as to where companies are going to grow, you want a roadmap as to where the talent is. And that talent is going to continue to convene and congregate in big cities like New York.
But even though companies are increasingly saying as a perk to hiring, and we're hearing this in massive surveys, employment surveys, that now a perk is you can work anywhere you want, that is going to, we know people are leaving jobs if they don't have that flexibility. That doesn't change things at
all. You're also having companies say that if you leave, your salary is going to be adjusted to reflect the cost of living where you're moving to. So I don't think we're going to fully understand those demographic trends until you see where people end up on the other side of COVID. And again, if we were together and you looked outside my window or you went to Central Park, I don't think you would be doubting the future of New York. And the same would be true if we were in Paris, London, Tokyo, Toronto, or Doha.
All right, just got a couple of minutes left. It has been quite a 12 months, 15 months, and we've had lots of conversations about real estate. Some final thoughts, Sheikh Khalid, for our audience about what they need to understand about where commercial real estate, residential real estate, where it's all going, and the impact of the pandemic.
If I speak on behalf of Qatari Diar, I think we look for opportunities, and so we look for commercial offices, retail, residential, hospitality. So there is a right opportunity, I think we jump on it. I think there is a great opportunities. Right now, people need just to take the risk and understand it well. But Qatari Diar will invest in all these, what I have just mentioned, areas where we see the opportunities is the right way to do.
So similar in terms of pre-pandemic. Bruce, come on in on this, because I do wonder, like logistics centers, data centers, is that more attractive? Is there something that's more attractive now that we've gone through the pandemic?
What Khalid should have said about his residential is he had some projects in London that he could sell to people that are listening to this call. But first, but I'll do his pitch for him. Look, here's what I would say. There's no doubt the one sector, and we've been investing significant amounts of money in it over the past 7-8 years. Data centers didn't exist really 15 years ago. There's enormous amounts of money going into the data center business, and it's going to continue for a long period of time. But when you look at the amount of capital in that area or in life science or in some of these niche areas, they're phenomenal investments, and they have been great investments, and they will be in the future, but they're relatively small dollars globally. And so, yes, they are great investments, but the true value investments today and where big money can be put to work and where significant value can be made is buying in these great cities today when people are have a different, more pessimistic view of them.
Rob, save 30 seconds for you. Final thoughts in terms of the outlook of where commercial real estate goes.
Stay nimble, stay flexible, stay liquid. And if you have a global purview like we do, like Brookfield does, like Qatar Diar does, you're going to find great opportunities in commercial real estate.
Going to leave it there. Rob Speyer in New York, Bruce Flatt in London, Sheikh Khalid in Doha. Thank you so much. Really appreciate your time. Be well.